My name's Diana Baldi. I grew up in Martins Ferry, Ohio, which is across the river from Wheeling, West Virginia, a steel town, as might be familiar to many of you. And so we're going to talk about time banking for the next few minutes. It's going to be quite a change from a prior speaker. I don't do any graphic design. But we'll talk about what time banking is and how it works and some of the challenges that you face and some success or ways to maybe be successful. My husband and I, we've traveled quite a bit. We've lived in several states and parts of the world. And so I guess I grew up in Martins Ferry where people helped each other. You know, you saw your parents helping out at school or at church, and so that spirit of volunteerism followed us. And so in Chicago area, we've worked with Destination Imagination, a children's group, 20 years, and then we dropped into Phoenixville a couple years ago, and we knew no one. No one, right? And so we also brought my mother-in-law and sister-in-law, who were highly dependent, with us from New Mexico. And their health really failed. So we were really struggling with how do we get along, how do we find help for them, how do we meet new people. And there was a social event from the Time Bank, and so we went to enjoy some food, and again, we were trying to meet people, so we would try to go to different things. And in that room, it was really kind of amazing. You know, we met a guy who was literally living on about $4,000 a year, and he was happy. He kind of gets to your point of view of he's happy with what he has, and he was there giving his time to other people, and he was thrilled to be able to ask for a ride to the doctor's appointment or to do something where he could ask amongst this community and get help. And so when people needed help, he was right there to help others as well. And so as someone that was kind of introducing us to the group said, yeah, this person, when I lost my job, they helped me, you know, make a resume. And this person helped me with this, and that person does this. And everybody in the room had some sort of a connection of helping each other. And then Orion Communities, this is a nonprofit organization in a town who 40% of their clients are homeless. The rest are in some sort of a transition in life. And they help them become more resilient and kind of, they're just a really great group. And so they introduced us to Orion, and we walked in and said, hey, we need help with our family members. They said, oh, and they gave us a list, Department of Health, and do this and do that. And so our Time Bank is a formal partner with several nonprofits in the area. And that means that when they need volunteers, they can put out a request to our group. And then, again, these folks that have a sense of volunteerism can rise to the challenge. So my real job for many years has been a management consultant. So I go into organizations, a whole wide variety of organizations, and assess their systems and help them streamline and improve, help with strategic planning and that. So for the Time Bank in 2008, I helped analyze the data that we had and really look at some of the challenges, and we kind of did the strategic plan. And then a few months later, they said, oh, by the way, could you be our president and kind of lead us into the future. And you'll see some of the challenges around that. So I want to give a proper credit to Edgar Kahn, because a long time ago, he really, it's like a visionary, right? Like, he had his own event where he became unable to do some things. And at the end of the presentation, I have a reference where you can go see the video about his life story and how he really started to look at the value of people. He wrote a book, No More Throwaway People. And his commitment to social justice is around when you kind of stereotype someone as a receiver, someone that has to be supported to have living conditions, that you often forget about the value that they have. And that's especially true when you look at that through the eyes of a market economy, where everything you do is based on money. And so some people's time is worth more. And so, but when you think about all the things that you do, like keeping your household in order and having companionship, those things are what you have to have in order to have a community, that the market doesn't place any value on that. But yet it's really valuable. You really wouldn't get along without that. And so the whole idea of time banking was built around social justice, reducing isolation. And it doesn't matter how much money you make or where you live, we all can feel that sense of isolation. And some can feel it, you know, much more dramatically than others, but it's an inherent thing that creeps up on each of us from time to time. And then how do you get the community? Again, when we moved from Annapolis, after 6 years, we met our neighbors at the yard sale they wanted to see what bargain they could get. Never saw these people, never met them. And that's unfortunately our new neighborhoods, right? Where you don't know the people that are by you. The other big driver for Edgar is basically recognizing civic engagement or volunteerism. And so the idea of if I do something, if I do something for you, sir, it takes me an hour, I get a time dollar. It's an imaginary time dollar. There's no value to it. But now that I'm rich because I have this imaginary thing, and then when our daughter moved, we could put out a request and say, hey, anybody have a truck? We have a few pieces of furniture she's trying to get from the restore. And someone says, hey, absolutely. And then we give them the time dollar. So that's the basics of time banking. So our core values is that each and every one of us has assets. Every single person. And that we need to honor all types of work, whether that, again, is something as simple as companionship or a ride to the airport, or whether you're doing, again, my helping with the strategic plan. If I were doing that with a corporate client, I would have given them a nice size bill. But those hours were valued as $1, one-time dollar. Also with volunteerism, this might be, again, where you might think of the JCs and Kiwanis and Rotary. Their whole vision is about giving and doing things for the community. With time banking, it's really essential to be two-way. Now, can you already hear yourself thinking, well, I don't need anything, or I don't know that I'd want to ask for that? Because there's some vulnerability around that, and vulnerability and shame follows pretty closely behind that. And so it's one of the things that we really have to work on is that freedom to be able to make a request as well as offer your talent. So we do a social every month, and it's really just so people become less afraid of each other. You know, because of the time bank, you see a list of people and their talents. But once I meet you, I'm like, oh, well, you're not so dangerous. I might trust you to walk my dog. Right? And and the idea of respect. Or I might need, you know, I would allow you to come into my home or to work together. So the Phoenixville area, which is where this time bank is, it was an old town. It's got a lot of historic places. As the steel mill closed down in the last hot coil was 76, I think, and then the entire factory was closed in 87. But because, I mean, the Phoenix, we've really come up with the rise of the Phoenix. So the mill was demolished. There's now apartment complexes there. Small businesses have moved in. But I think fundamentally what makes unique Phoenixville unique is that not only are there 60 nonprofits in a pretty small town, but they work together. And it's a network and it's a collaborative spirit. They've also, I don't know if you've heard of Transition Town, but Media Pennsylvania has been spearheading efforts, and we have a pretty significant effort in Phoenixville. And Transition Town is, again, one of the references at the back. But to give you a sense, there's downtown. I mean, the mill was right downtown. And as we talked about the smoke and the people living around there, the air quality is not that. But now, all those buildings on the right, those are all apartment complexes. So we lived in one of the U-shaped ones. There were 350 apartments now in that one place. They kept the foundry. It's now like one of the best places or sought after places for weddings. It's been restored. There's been a lot of effort there. So our time bank started. Edgar actually came to town, went to Camp Hill Sultan. It's an organization that helps folks with disabilities be, accepted and respected. And so a fiscal sponsor helped us get started. And then we're one of few time banks in the United States that actually maintains the 501c3 status. And so far we have about close to 42 now. So the idea of enhancing volunteerism, that you generate this idea of self-worth because your time is valued. So we've talked about that. So how could we do it? Well, it could be from one individual to another individual. Now, when you know them, that's pretty easy, but at the beginning, that might be a little scary. And that's, again, one of the reasons we do the socials, so people understand that once you share time with someone, you build that trust. Or in one of the pictures, we were at a garden where someone had a garden, it was kind of overgrown, so about six of us came and we were in the mud and weeding. We had three big wheelbarrows of weeds, right? But weeding a garden is boring by yourself, but in a group where you could chatter, it kind of makes work fun. And then this particular lady actually rewarded us with a homemade pie, right? So then our partner organizations, we have the Code Blue, which is a warming center where folks without a bed can go and sleep at night and during the winter. And so we have groups of people that help with laundry and inventory. And with Orion, we help them with a variety of initiatives that they do. So again, we could go as a group or we could go as individuals. For me, the Park House Rehabilitation Center, a nursing home, that was one where I met Melinda. She wasn't scary. And she said, oh yeah, come on out. When they do events, they just need people to help move the wheelchairs from the floors down to the entertainment center. And so that's how I get my Fitbit steps in, right? By just going there. But again, as a group, like I might not go to a nursing home as an individual. It's a bit scary. But as part of a group, it's a lot easier to say yes. So you need some sort of a system where people can make offers and make requests. And so you need some sort of an exchange system. So this could be pen and paper, whether it's a bulletin board, whether it's virtual or paper, or you could have a simple thing. Now, that graphic doesn't show up, but it's actually a nice, one of the ones in Germany made, it looks like an actual bill. So they, again, they just hand off the bill when they do their exchanges. And then for the software, there's two main ones that I've been able to find. Community Weaver, which is part of TimeBank USA, and Time and Talent, which is part of another network of TimeBanks called Our World. So these are just some of the statistics about the two different organizations. One of the things I find, Community Weaver just started to charge a fee for the software, because as any of you that work with software know, there is a lot of work to maintain things and make improvements. But the percentage of time banks that are active is much higher on the TimeBank USA than on the Our World. I think because there's no fee, people start up and they don't realize that there are challenges and it's not going to just happen automatically. So the idea that I don't have anything to give, we see that in every demographic. I don't know what I have. Well, then we make a list, right? Or I don't need anything. Recruiting people and keeping people engaged and then keeping track of the hours. So this is our statistics of when we started up. The yellow line is the membership, and then the orange is who joined, right? Those are the enthusiastic folks, and then the gray is who dropped out. So my point about this is that you need someone, that there's going to be a churn of people in and out, but you need some sort of a coordinator that's helping people make, to stay engaged. And you, so that leadership or how you're gonna manage the exchanges, governance, if you're gonna do this, whether it's gonna be a formal organization or informal, again, we're a little more formal, so we need to have insurance and places to do things. So one of our, when we start helping other time banks start up, one of the things that Joel does is have them list all the resources you already have in the area. Who are the movers and shakers? What are the needs? What are the assets that you have? And then who's the core group going to be that are aligned with these core values? There's a new website that's started up from gatheringwithapurpose.net, and they have a few things where, again, where you could do an event and you could have half the people in the room get a card that says you're going to ask for something, the other half get a card that say, I'm going to do something for somebody. And so you go through the emotions of time banking, and you meet again and talk about the experience of doing the exchange. And so we think this is going to be a great way to have time bank start, where the people understand the emotional parts of time banking before they just sign up and say it sounds like a good thing. So we're hoping this will help maintain engagement. And then there are other mentor time banks that could help you. Decide, all these things. We do have limits of support. So, for example, we don't do personal care like bathing or giving medicine, things that there are other organizations that have certification of personnel and training. And again, depending on how you set up. So, in summary, it's a great concept. Like, I'm so excited. We've done a lot of work this past 6 months on just refining bylaws and core procedures and setting up the framework to get ready to turn over to have it be a more sustainable organization. The fact that we've made it 15 years is really good, but we want to get ready for the next 15. And as long as you go into it understanding that there's going to be some effort to keep it moving, it'd be great. And I wanted to extend the invitation. Dr. Khan turned 83 March 23rd. He's a visionary of our time. He's also a really nice person. He's coming to Phoenixville April 28th at 7 o'clock, and we'd love, if you'd like to meet him and carry on the discussion, you're very welcome. Our website has a way you can make a reservation. And then there's some resources for you. And the top one on here says, well, you want to start as a formal group going all the way to a legal entity, just some of the things to think about there. And Transition Town is another initiative about equity that, again, I thought this group would be interested in. So I know it's probably time for break. I'd be glad I brought one of our new brochures and my cards, and be glad to chat with folks informally, because I think we don't have time for questions. But thank you.